We are heading in that direction, and I hope we'll be there soon. But you were saying that you have the second day and all this clinical experience helped you. But of course, you might have, like, you did practice in Goa, but then did you prepare again in home? Did you buy something and started practicing?
For practical examination, there is a typhodont called Columbia 860, which is a type of typhodonts which are used in Australian Dental Council. And in India, there is a distributor called Nauda in Mumbai. He sells all the ADC mannequins, ADC typhodont, and everything you need as far as teeth, because it's very important. No matter how much you practice. Oh, so let me put it very straight for all the dental students, the general practitioners, the MDS guys, and everybody. So to clear ADC clinical task, even if I know people who have zero clinical experience, who have cleared without any effort, means they came in, they had never ever practiced a general practice or any kind of practice. All they did is they went on this Columbia typhodonts. They got it right on the typhodonts. They went and performed in the examination and they cleared with flying colors. I know practitioners who have been practicing for 20 years who have not cleared the examination. I know postgraduate students like orthodontists, you know, who have nothing to do with cavity preparations. All they did was the orthodontics all their life. They came in, they cleared the examination. So the bottom line is my journey is very different than anybody else's. But none, whatever you are, whether you're a general practitioner, a student with experience, without experience, as long as you get it right on these typhodonts, you can clear. But you should know what you're doing. You need to practice.
So how many months did you practice for the exam?
See, to be honest, I used to work from 9 in the morning till maybe 7:30, because in Goa, we had siesta break in the afternoon. So 1:30 to 4:30, we had a lunch and slept. So morning 9:30 to around 1:30 and 4 to 7:30. So 7:30, I used to be back home. And once I'm back home, maybe we would just go for a walk and come back. And I may have practiced for 1 to 1.5 hours a day on a typhodont, because the feel of a typhodont is very different than the feel of a natural tooth. So other than that, as long and at the same time, these have pretty standard anatomical configurations. So it is always useful to know how a typhodont looks. Like for imagine, like, you know, a six, how it should look. There will be a perfect anatomy on Columbia typhodont. But they may give you the same tooth for a pre-cut tooth for a class two restorations. So you should know the difference in cusp height. You should know how what's a relation between a mesiobuccal and a distobuccal cusp. You know, you should know how much of a 0.5 or 0.2 millimeter difference, because mesiobuccal cusp should be a bit higher, distobuccal should be a bit lower. So these relationships should be kind of put back into the restoration to have an ideal restoration. You know, so these are the things where you need to purchase. So let me put it in a way. Okay, if you want to prepare for part two examination, prepare for OSCEs. There are situation-based questions. In OSCEs, one of the things you have to understand, you have to learn to improve your communication, which is the single most important factor which is going to make you or break you. So when it comes to kind of OSCEs, the single most important thing is something called as attaining an informed consent, which is very, very important. What is informed consent? When anybody comes in, you should be able to diagnose. You should be able to explain the diagnosis in patient's own language, not using any clinical words. You should be able to explain so that a normal person who has no clue about anything should be able to understand you. You should be able to give him options. You should be able to give him all the risks associated with the procedure. You should be able to tell what is the cost, even if it is an imaginary cost, doesn't matter. And every patient has a right to see or opt to see a specialist. So if you explain all these factors in every OSCE or every clinically simulated area where you have diagnosis, options, risk, okay, you have cost, you have specialist referrals. If you incorporate this kind of approach to any communication, and if you practice it, no matter where you are, you will do fine. Why we always lack, you know, coming from a country like India, because, and you should be always be very patient. That's the most important factor. If when you're talking, if the patient starts talking, you should know to quiet down and stay quiet and listen to him completely. If you stop any patient in between a conversation or in between a consultation, it is considered very wrong. So these are the things, you know, like basic, the very basic. So, and one more very important thing, I would say part two, start learning infection control. I'm pretty sure because of COVID now, everybody knows about respirators and this and that. But I would say if you want to appear for any of this examination, the most essential part is infection control, where in every dental office, you have to divide the area into clean and dirty zones. So if you're really serious, you want to come to Australia and practice in the Australian Dental Council examination setup. From day one, understand what is the sequence of wearing a mask or a personal protective equipment, which involves a disposable gown, a mask, and eye shield. What is the way you take it off? Okay, in a clinical situation, where are the clean instruments? You understand the concept of transfer tweezers. You understand dirty zone where a particular patient has been treated and all the things associated with them are in that area. So understand infection control. This is very important. This is one place it really took me time to understand is infection control. What is infection control? In short, I'll put it like in every dental office, there will be two areas close to patient. One will be considered a clean zone and another one dirty zone. Dirty zone, you can pick up whatever you want from the dirty zone and treat the patient. But if you want something from the clean zone, either you need to use a transfer tweezer from the clean zone, or you need to change your gloves, sterilize your hands, and then only you can pick up things from the clean zone. So if you understand this, then many things are very simple. So infection control, communication, and rest, I feel everybody can clear rest of the examination.
How much of the expenses, especially for the fees and the amount of material which you have to purchase, if you remember?
So the cost of Australian Part 2 examination has dropped. When we appeared, it was $6,000. And now it is $4,500, which is approximately 2.4 lakhs Indian rupees. And the cost associated with typhoodonts and the clinical setup and materials. Like if you already have a running practice, it will be very low because all you need is typhoodonts. Rest everything is available. But just imagine if you are a student, then you may have to buy a small compressor. You may have to buy a portable unit of a handpiece and with a bottle, you know, you get it on eBay or any of Amazon. You get portable units, you can connect it to the compressor and connect a handpiece and have a bench mount a typhoodont like the mannequin, and you can sit with a like a reading light and you can work at home. So for a general practitioner, I would say the cost of mannequin and the amount of materials will need at least 1.5 lakhs easy or more. Or for a person who has no clinical setup and who wants to practice at home, it will be easy 2.5 lakhs, which involves around 50,000 odd rupees or 60,000 odd rupees for the mannequin. And then if you want to buy the original mannequin, then it will cost you even more. So you can say anywhere ranging between 1.5 to 3.5 lakhs, depending upon how many teeth you practice on, depending upon what kind of setup you got.
This practical exam has to be given in Australia. Does it happen every month, every day, or there are slots for it?
So this is another good point, you know, because when we appeared for the examination, they were only twice a year it used to happen. So we really had to wait, you know, and seats used to get filled up like nothing, you know, like sometimes, like I didn't get a couple of times, like one entire year, I didn't even get a option to appear for the examination because it got full. But luckily now it happens pretty much every month. So that's the reason as far as part two dates are concerned, I feel it's not a big issue. As long as you have cleared part one examination, you can always appear for part two very easily. But the problem here is the travel restriction because of COVID. Because we came here first time to appear for the examination on tourist visa. And that's how everybody comes in. We come in on a 3 or a 6 month tourist visa. We appear for the examination and then we go back. Because we come in as a tourist and that's very easy to apply online. But now, for unforeseeable future, maybe for another 1 year, it may be difficult to get any tourist visa for anybody. So that's the reason there will be a bit of delay as far as even if you clear part one, you may not be able to come to Australia to appear for the examination.
Do they have any validity after you clear the exam? That
it used to be a 3 year validity, and I'm pretty sure it is still the same. Once you clear part one examination, you have to clear part two examination within 3 years. Or maybe there is a kind of waiver for that. I don't know, but I'm not very sure. But our time, it used to be a 3 year. Part one, part two, once you clear part one, you have to clear part two within 3 years, no matter the number of attempts. So it doesn't make a difference how many times you have appeared for the examination. But it gets expensive.
How much is the visa charge actually, if you remember?
So I don't remember, but tourist visas are normally around maybe 10,000 rupees or something.
The flight charges, if you can include that.
Flight charges, you know, like realistically, like I was there in India last year and I flew in as cheap as maybe 50,000 up and down, two way. Okay, and if you really want to be economical, you can fly budget airlines like the Tiger Airway or something, you know, or Malaysian Airway, and you may get an up and down ticket for as cheap as 40,000. This is, I'm talking about pre-COVID times. Now, these days, even a one-way ticket costs you around 2.5 lakhs.
Now, we are coming to the important part, which I'm sure once you clear the exam, people really wonder, or sometimes people wonder before clearing the exam, that how easy is to get the job after you clear the exam. The second important question is, which is the visa which you should have to get the job, or, you know, maybe something is related to it.
Okay, so let me put it straight. You know, like back in 2015, when I was about to appear for my practical exam, people started saying, oh, there's a lot of saturation, you know, like there are no jobs and so many things, you know, like, and one thing people should understand, forget, there is so many people talking so many things which are really not important in your life. So if you want to achieve something, focus your attention on achieving that. Somebody told me, oh, these days, there are not many people are sending overseas dentists back because there are no jobs, or it is so hard to find a job, it is not worth it, and this and that. I'll tell you a simple example where I am. A couple of my friends here have practices, and they've been looking for a dentist for the last 6 months, and they could not find one. So it should answer your question. So if you want to be in the Central Sydney or Brisbane CBD, and if you want to work in the kind of most poshest kind of a practice, if you have that kind of a credential, like you are a postgraduate, like you are an endodontist from India, or you are a general practitioner who is really good in India, you may still secure it. But like even as a guy who has no experience in India and who has cleared Australian Dental Council examination, you may go through one or 2 years of a job, which is comparatively less lucrative than other jobs, but still more than average. Okay. Like it may compare, means you may be earning a bit less than other dentists who are paid well. But over a bigger picture, you can have a very comfortable life. So as long as you clear the examination, I would say these are the distractions you should, few distractions I will tell you, which you always consider not to listen to. One, Australian Dental Council exam is too tough, or it's too difficult to get into the exam, and it's a really, you know, I know friends, you know, who are never cleared, you know, and there are no jobs. I would not agree with these things. 100%. Okay, there will be enough jobs even for next many years. Even today, it is one of the best professions in Australia. You can still have a very comfortable life. So, and it's a country which is really multicultural. So your standard of living is very good. So in any way, I would not listen to anybody. Like if somebody comes and tells you something negative about the examination, just ignore him. So there is so many opportunities here, and it is a examination which luckily for us, we can partly do it in India and partly we can come here and do it. So there is, and regarding visa, okay, once you, one very important thing when it comes to visa, once you clear Australian Dental Council exams, if you are working, please make sure you file your tax returns if you're self-employed. Because when it comes to visa, there are points for everything. Like there are points for how many years you have worked for. Okay, you may have worked for 0 years, 0 to 1, 1 to 3, 3 to 5, 5 to 10. And if you claim points for say 5 to 10 years of experience, you should be able to prove it. So that's the reason. If you're working for somebody, and even if you're receiving a small amount, let's say you're receiving just a 1,000 rupees a month, please make sure that money from the employer gets into your bank account. And end of the year, please file your tax returns. Because once it gets into the bank, once you file the taxes, it is easy to prove that, you know, okay, you worked so many years, you have evidence. Because everything else, you can work around it. Age, nobody can change it. Okay, your qualification, nobody can change it. But when it comes to number of hours experience, number of years of experience outside Australia, that's where I see a biggest problem in claiming points. Because in India, maybe we are so used to taking money in hand, you know, in cash. So even if you take a good amount of money in cash, put something into your bank from the employer, it doesn't matter. Even if it is a small amount, make sure the money from your employer goes into the bank. If you are a self-employed person, keep a proper accounting details, tax audits or whatever. You know, make sure you have enough financial documents which support your claim. So now, in short, the pathway to Australia are two. One is called regional sponsored visa. So regional sponsored visa means you need to be living and working in a regional part of Australia for a minimum of 3 years. Okay. And in those 3 years, it directly leads to your permanent residency because they want more people in the regional towns. Okay. And the second one is employer sponsored visa. Where, like, you know, if I have a dental practice and I need a dentist, and all I need to do is show the council that I can't find a dentist, so I'm getting a dentist from overseas. So I would not highly recommend an employer-sponsored stream, because once you get involved in the employer-sponsored stream, you may be stuck with that employer. So unless you really know that employer to be a really good person or really genuine person, I would say there's still a lot of opportunities for regional state-sponsored visas. Apply for it. The pathway is very simple. Get into Australian immigration website. Okay. Look for it. Everything is there. I didn't, like, agent, when I cleared my ADCs, I asked the agent. He said he's going to charge me 2 lakh rupees or something just to get the visa done. I went to the website. I did all the paperwork myself, sent it across. No problem. I got the visa. So the cost of visa was around.
The second route, what you are saying is that is by the government. You have to apply for it.
Yes.
And you get that visa and you go to Australia.
Yes.
And then you apply for a job there.
Yes, that's right. So I would not recommend the employer-sponsored stream because though maybe few of them have good experiences, most of them, they eventually land up with conflict with their employers because you don't, because in a state-sponsored visa, like if you don't like the employer, you can just move on, you know, like you can find, because there are 100 jobs available. Yeah, you can go anywhere, regional. And regional doesn't mean it is like, you know, rural or there's nothing. It's pretty much, I would say, like where I am today, this town has hardly a population of 6,000 people. But we have all the facilities. So there may be a few hundred of these places on the coast in Australia. Every place is as beautiful as Goa, I would say. So you have the good lifestyle, you know, like coastal towns, you know, everything you need. But some of them, they like to go to big towns, you know, they like a bit of flashy life. Yeah. For them, there is Brisbane, Melbourne, you know, like Sydney, wherever you want. People come here, work for 2-3 years, make money, and then go get into Sydney or Brisbane or wherever they want. So, but for me, I like more of a regional towns, and that's the reason even I was in Goa, a bit away from hustle bustle of big towns. At the same time, you have a coast and a beach to enjoy during your weekends. Yes.
So what is the benefit of PR once you get it?
So I'll tell you, like if you have a PR right away, like how we used to get PR right away when we were in SOL or skilled occupational list, the moment you come in, you have something called as Medicare. Okay, Medicare is nothing but you get free health. Yeah, health. It's kind of a health insurance which gives you access to all the public hospitals. You can go to a GP, a doctor or anybody, and government covers the consultation and your treatment. You can get into some things, or if any of your family wants to study any further, you can get a free loan from the government. A free loan means you can access the government loan scheme, you know, where you can access money for your further education. Moreover, other benefits include what else? Yeah, like visa-free travel. You don't have to worry. You know, like so. After a few years of having permanent residency, I guess around 5 years after you have a permanent residency, you can get a citizenship. Okay, so yeah, there's not a huge kind of a. It's important that you have PR, but citizenship is up to you. You know, whether you still want to keep your Indian citizenship or whether you want to convert it into Australian. It's everybody have their own reasons, you know, and I feel it's of no importance. But the entire idea is to come and practice here as a dental practitioner, as well as to achieve your PR, permanent residence. These are the two important factors. So you should work towards ADC exam, get your license. And once you have the license, you should work towards your visa. Whether it gives you PR 2 years down the line or 3 years down the line, go towards a visa system which gives you a PR. So if you achieve this, you know, more than enough.
Given a chance to change something in the Indian dental curriculum, what would be that, you know, one or two things?
See, I was never a fan of dental schools. Let me be honest. You know, like I would say, these days, there are better platforms to learn, you know, let it be YouTube or let it be any other form of online, because I learned a lot just online, you know. So I feel university education is pretty monotonous and boring. Okay, like this is my personal view, okay?
No, even I also do agree, because that's why we started with the Aspire 32 channel. When I came across a channel called as Khan Academy, that is how I got a thought of teaching and reaching the masses with this platform. So that I absolutely agree with what you say.
Yeah, because I feel there are things like practical class, like practical sessions. It is important that you go to university. Like I feel there should be an option where a person can be at home or wherever he is. He completes a fixed amount of things. And then you come to a clinical setup and where you understand the practical implications of what you learned. Okay. And at the same time, let it be one more thing I would, this is my personal opinion, is like how we do the rotatory internship. You know, like we go into one department, spend so much time, you know, go to the next department and third department. I feel that whole process should be halved, you know, like so that you do it for first 6 months. And next 6 months, I feel there should be a kind of a place where you treat a person who comes in from start to end, a comprehensive examination, you know, because I feel it takes time for students to kind of, you know, if you're in surgery, you're just extracting or doing something. I feel a bit of training should be given where people come in and somebody walks in, you know how to approach. How do you gonna sort out his problems? You know, if somebody comes with a toothache, okay, you can sort out his toothache for the first day as an emergency treatment. And then you should be able to give him a pathway. Okay, this is where you start and this is where you end. And I'm going to apply all the skills I learned in all those departments in getting you to the health, optimal health. That's all about general practice. You know, I feel that's a pathway, you know, which should be taught in university.
Recently, everybody has told us that the foreign universities teach the same way. I hope we would reach there. I would really, you know, I'm really thankful to your time and looking back where you were and where you are now. That's a long journey, but that is truly inspiring journey. Nobody would have thought maybe 10 years back that you would reach Australia. And today, I'm sure this podcast will give so much of guidance and hope to everyone who watches it on Aspire 32.
My message to all the people who want to pursue this Australian Dental Council examination. See, I don't know about the government policies as far as travel restrictions. I'm pretty sure it's going to be lifted somewhere soon. And once it's lifted, it's a good option. Whether you are an undergraduate student, whether you are an intern, whether you are a general practitioner, whether you are a postgraduate, or whatever, okay, is a good option. Because after all, once you qualify as a dentist in Australia, whatever additional qualities you have, whether you're an endodontist or orthodontist, this country gives you opportunity to practice. Even as a general practitioner, you can do orthodontics. As long as you know what you're doing, you can do it. You want to do anything other than, you know, major surgeries or anything. But every skill you learn in, it will add a big advantage on top of you. But is there a prerequisite to get into this exam or to clear this exam? I'll make it clear, your experience or non-experience, it doesn't matter. There is a set rule. There's a set level of expectation from the examination council, which a new grad can clear. An intern, if he is eligible and if he can really put his head, he can clear. A person who's been practicing for 10 years can clear. An orthodontist or an endodontist can clear. So there's no limitation. Don't hold yourself back with people telling you, oh, it's so difficult. Yeah, I feel if you want to do it, you'll do it. Only implication is the cost, that something, you know, you have to somehow manage, because the cost implications, I would say, approximately runs around 15 to 20 lakhs. Yeah, over the course of examination, when you come here, air tickets and everything. If you're lucky, you get it right in the single go, 15 lakhs. But once you graduate and enter the country, believe me, that cost is not significant. But when we are in India, when we are earning in rupees, yes, even it pinched me when I came to Australia. Yeah, a coffee pinched me. I said, oh, that's a bit expensive. Now I don't mind paying for that.
I'm sure this podcast would be really helpful to everyone, sir. Thank you so much for your time and coming on Aspire 32. My dear viewers, we'll see you once again on Aspire 32 with one more such amazing person who will be sharing their own journey and their struggle and inspire you a lot. Bye for now.